Hello students, today our topic for discussion is Introduction to Economics. This is the chapter 1 of class 12. Let's start with the term economics. What is economics? Actually, economics is made up of two Greek language words, oikos and nomos, which together called as oikonomia means to manage the household. Now the question is, what is household? Household may be your own home, your society or your country. Actually, there are two types of activities which a household has to manage. One, economic activities and the other, non-economic activities. But our subject economics is concerned only with economic activities of the household. Now, what are these economic activities? Economic activities are those activities which are done in monetary terms. For example, see what happens. If your mother gives you 500 rupees on your birthday, what will you do of that? Option 1, you may buy a dress. Option 2, you may watch a movie. Option 3, you may go to a restaurant. Option 4, you may enjoy with your friends. Option 5, you may purchase books. Option 6, you may save the amount. Like, there are lots of many things which you want to do, as your wants are always unlimited. But resources to satisfy them are also limited. And these resources have alternative uses, that is, they have many uses. So there is a problem of choice making, or problem of allocation of resources as they are limited. There will be the same case even if your mother has given you rupees 5000, rupees 50,000, rupees 5 lakh, or even if she had given rupees 50 lakh on your birthday, the position will be same because your wishes will arise according to resources and still the result will be same. That is, wants will be still unlimited, resources will be still limited, and alternative uses of resources. Now, this is the economics which guides us what we should choose. That want which gives us maximum satisfaction. So, this was the need due to which the subject of economics emerged. Now, in how many parts economics can be divided? In the beginning, there was only one economics known as political economy or simply economics. But after 1930, some economists divided the economics into two parts, microeconomics and macroeconomics. Firstly, we will make clear the concept of microeconomics. The word micro is derived from Greek word micros, M-I-K-R-O-S, means small, tiny. Microeconomics deals with the behavior of individual elements in an economy, such as the determination of the price of a single product, or it deals with the behavior of a single consumer, or microeconomics deals with the behavior of a single business firm. Microeconomics is the study of one particular unit, and that particular unit may be a household or a factor input. It is microeconomics which deals with the problem of price determination and allocation of resources. The main tools of microeconomics are demand and supply of commodities and demand and supply of factors. Microeconomics is also known as price theory. Let us see some examples which are covered under microeconomics. These are the topics which we study in the subject microeconomics, and these are theory of consumer behavior, theory of production and cost, price determination of product under different market conditions. Like, different market conditions may be when there is a change only in demand, or when there is a change only in supply or simultaneously there is a change in both. Now this change may be by the same proportion in demand and supply. There may be change in demand more or there may be change in supply more. In microeconomics, we consider the pricing of factors of production. Factors of production are land, labor, capital and entrepreneur. That is, in microeconomics, we study the theory of wages, rent and profit. Microeconomics is also concerned with general equilibrium analysis and sometimes it is also known as welfare economics. So students, it was all about the microeconomics. Now the turn of macroeconomics. The word macro is also derived from the Greek language word makros, M A K R O S, which means large. Macroeconomics may be defined as that branch of economic theory which studies the behavior of all units combined together. It is a study of aggregates. It is the study of behavior of economy as a whole. As Professor Kernel also has suggested that macroeconomics is the study of forest and not the trees. That is, macroeconomics examines the overall level of a nation's output, nation's employment, nation's prices and foreign trade. As microeconomics is termed as price theory, likewise macroeconomics is also known as theory of income and employment. Some broad areas covered by macroeconomics are theories of business cycles like boom, depression, recession, theories of inflation, theories of deflation, theories of economic growth, theory of national income, national output and employment with its constituents like consumption function and investment function. So students, remember, today no area of economics is more important for a nation's success than its macroeconomic performance. Or we can say that macroeconomics has a significant position in today's economy. So now, from above mentioned discussion, we have seen that there is a difference between microeconomics and macroeconomics. But remember, there is a difference between the two terms, but they do not oppose each other. Instead, these two terms are complementary to each other. As it has been rightly pointed out by Professor Alfred Marshall that as both foot are needed for walking, in the same way, micro and macroeconomics both are needed for a scientific thought. Importance of anyone cannot be ignored. It was all about the macroeconomics. Now, what is the nature of economics? Under this heading, we generally discuss whether economics is a science or it is an art, or economics is both. Before going into this heading, we have to know what is science. Any subject can be regarded as science if it has all the following features. Let's see the features of science. Science is a systematic body of facts. Science establishes relationship between cause and effect. Science is capable of measurement. Science has ability to forecast. In science, laws are derived based on experiments. Now, if we analyze economics or if we compare economics with science, we can say that economics also has the features of science. Like science, it studies cause and effect relationship between economic phenomena. Let us take an example of law of demand. As price rises, quantity demanded falls and vice versa, keeping other things constant. In this law of demand, price is the cause and effect is change in quantity demanded. The second similarity between economics and science is that economics is also capable of being measured in terms of money. Third similarity is that economics also forecast the future market conditions with the help of various statistical and non-statistical tools. In economics also, experiments are done. It's okay, not in laboratories, but on human behavior. On the basis of above analysis, we can say that economics is science. But remember, it is not a perfect science due to some inherent limitations in it. Means economics has certain inherent shortcomings, like laws of economics are not universally true like science. Laws of economics are applicable under certain conditions, usually referred to as other things being equal or ceteris paribus, which make these laws less realistic. The second shortcoming of economics is that money, which is used in economics to measure the outcome, is itself a dependent variable. The subject matter of economics is human behavior, which is highly unpredictable. Human behavior goes on changing. Then how law based on human behavior can be regarded as correct when human behavior goes on continuously changing? Next limitation of economics is predictions. Predictions in economics are also not always accurate. On the basis of entire analysis, it is proved that economics is science but not perfect science. Now the question arises whether economics is positive science or normative science. First of all, we should know the meaning of both these terms. First, the term positive. Positive science means accept what exists, or it means as they are. Positive science does not pass value judgments. It does not give moral suggestions. It does not suggest what should be. Rather, positive science focuses only on what is. It does not tell what is right and what is wrong. Professor Lionel Robbins, a renowned economist, supported this positive aspect of economics. Examples of positive science are, first, prices in India are continuously falling. We have to accept it as a fact. Second example, there is an inverse relationship between price and quantity demanded. Now the term normative science. Normative science means what ought to be, what should be. It gives moral judgments like what should be done and what should not. It is concerned with welfare propositions. Professor Alfred Marshall and Professor A.C. Pigou supported this side. Examples of normative science are, first, reducing inequalities should be the major priority for mixed economies. See, there may be many priorities for mixed economies, but the major priority should be the reducing inequality. Here it is a suggestion. It focuses on what should be. So it is a normative statement. Secondly, the government ought to guarantee that our income will not fall. The government ought to guarantee. Again, remember, it is a suggestion. So these were the examples of normative aspect of economics. To conclude, we may say that while laying down laws or theories, economics may be treated as pure and positive science, but as a tool of practical application, it must have some normative goals in view. It was all about science, positive science, normative science. Now the next question which arises in our mind is whether economics is an art also. Yes, our answer is positive. Students, art means practice of knowledge. Economics is an art also because its various branches, consumption, production, etc., provide practical solutions to various economic problems which we face in our day-to-day life. Concludingly, it is proved that economics is both a science and an art. Further, both positive science and normative science. But point to remember is that economics is not a perfect science. So students, this was all for our today's discussion. Rest we will do in our next class. But before leaving, let's summarize what we have done today. We started a chapter with the meaning and need of economics. And we look, economics is made up of two words, oikos and nomos, which combinedly means to manage the household. Economics teaches us to make the choices. It guides us in choice making. It suggests us to make that choice which gives us maximum satisfaction in the face of scarcity of resources. So you see, this is the choice making due to which the need of economics emerged. Some economists also defined economics as science of choice making. Next, we came to know about types of economies, that is micro and macro, the two important sides of economies which should be taken together. Then we discussed the nature of economics, in which we proved that economics is both a science and an art, and further both positive science and normative science, but not a perfect science. So students, now there are some multiple choice questions for making your concepts more clear. Question first, identify the statement which is micro from national angle. I am giving you four options. You have to identify that statement which is micro from national angle. First option is per capita income of India. Second option is underemployment in agricultural sector. Third option is lockout in biscuit industry, and fourth option is total savings in India. Yes, you are right. Our answer is option C, lockout in biscuit industry. As you see, per capita income is a macro approach. Underemployment in agricultural sector is also macro from national angle, and total savings in India is also macro aspect. Our second question is, an example of positive economic analysis would be, means I am giving you four options and you have to identify that statement which is positive, that is the statement in which suggestions are not given. The first statement is determining the fair price for the food. Second is deciding how to distribute the output of the economy. Third is determining how much income each person should be guaranteed. And fourth option is an analysis of the relationship between the price of food and the quantity purchased. Yes, this is none other than our option fourth. As you see, in all the above three options, we are making suggestions what should be done and what should be not. But in the fourth option, there is only an analysis of relation, which is cause-effect relationship, and this is positive. Our third question is, choice is created due to. First option, abundance of resources. Second option, urgency of needs. Third option, non-availability of resources. and fourth option, scarcity of resources. Yes, this is scarcity of resources. We have to make choices because resources are scarce. Next question is, which is the branch of economic theory that deals with allocation of resources? Remember that branch of economic theory that deals with allocation of resources. Your first option is microeconomic theory. Second is macroeconomics theory. Third is econometrics, and fourth is political economics. So it is microeconomics, because as we know, microeconomics is that branch of economics which deals with allocation of resources. Now, last question for our consideration is, the term economics is derived from which two Greek words, combinedly known as eikonomia, vikonomia, oikonomia or psychonomia? Yes, it is oikonomia. So friends, it was all for today. Thank you.